The cost for lawn signs is just a flash in a bucket compared to what some candidates spend. And at least one group says that millions raised for campaigns could be put to better use.
Thanks to
you've seen their political ads. You've seen their rallies and signs. Those campaigning efforts don't come cheap. The Federal Election Commission tracks how much candidates raise and their disbursements, which is what they've spent so far. Here's the commission's latest figures for the Kansas House races and its one Senate race. Democrats, Republicans, and minor parties have spent over $14 million on the House races. In the Senate race, almost $10 million. In Missouri, including all candidates, more than $15 million has been spent in the House races. More than $17 million has been spent in the Senate race. Here's how those dollars break down in the battle between Robin Carnahan and Roy Blunt for the Missouri Senate seat.
The Federal Election Commission estimates that both Robin Carnahan and Roy Blunt spent more than $8 million on their separate campaigns. That's more than 19,000 round-trip flights to Hawaii, or maybe one big trip to Vegas if you're a gambler. Or maybe you can buy 18 of the most expensive cars that Porsche makes. They're just $440,000 a pop. How about that $8 million diamond bra worn by several famous Victoria's Secret models? Well, on a more serious note, at least one local charity says they can make big dollars like that go much farther.
We're very concerned about this Christmas season that's coming up. We're seeing, we're anticipating that what we saw last year is just going to continue to grow.
Captain Rebecca Simmons with the Salvation Army says last year donations stayed the same, but the charity saw a higher number of people in need.
Any charity is probably saying they're functioning on minimal staff just because the economy is so tight. And so most charities could, you know, utilize funds to hire that program staff to do better quality program and to reach out even more to people.
For a look at what candidates are spending in other races, you can log on to fox4kc.com. Mary Pulley, Fox 4 News, working for you.
They've always been around.
It's very illegal.
It may be a business to him that it's off the books. We're getting complaints of it with minors possibly going in and out of there.
They've had a couple shootings in the last 30 days. We've gotten to with the prosecutor's office and come up with a game plan that we're going to try to stamp out some of these party houses and let the citizens and the community sleep at night.
Blacking out. Copy.
Go, boys.
Go.
Please start war!
Basically, almost like any other bar would be. You know, there's a pool table and you know, refrigerator, a little makeshift bar area, sitting area back there too, and some alcohol. There's no licensing. They're selling alcohol illegally. Basically, just an illegal business. $10 just to get into the door. $10 a drink. If you leave and come back, it's $5 more to get back into it. It will be tagged. It's basically a cease and assist order.
All right, zip on up.
They're strewn all over the city, and they are they're a nuisance. They're a hazard. They bring violence. They bring assaults. They bring robberies, homicides. You know, they bring all sorts of things to the community.
We were here on one crime, and it, you know, it led to more issues and maybe actually solve a problem in this neighborhood. Since we've been here, we actually found out that it's a huge party house in the neighborhood. A lot of people have been complaining about it, so we're following up on some of that. We have some obvious codes violations and stuff, and I'm bringing the fire marshal out because we think the house may be a hazard, so I'm hoping the fire marshal will look at that, and you know, maybe it's something that we can get shut down before it hurts one of these other people.
I want them to know we're out there. We're not going to take party houses lightly.
We're going to look at everything and see if we can't help this neighborhood out.
Those who knew Nathan Stiles say he had a bright future to look forward to. As an honor roll student, star athlete, and member of his church's choir, they say nothing was going to hold him back from achieving success.
How happy and joyful he was. He never made anyone's day bad. He lightened everyone's day up when you talked to him.
But that bright future became dim Thursday night. Nathan took a hard hit and made his way to the sidelines.
Considering he was seizing a little bit, he was, seemed life-threatening.
He collapsed on the sidelines and was eventually life-flighted to the University of Kansas Hospital. He died early Friday morning.
This morning when I woke up to that text message, I just pretty much fell out of bed and started crying.
Exactly what caused Nathan's death isn't yet known, but he had suffered a concussion earlier in the season, which with other injuries had kept him off the field for several weeks.
Nathan was
well-known, highly regarded, very well-respected young man.
To help the community grieve, Spring Hill High School and Grace Community Church held a vigil Friday night to mourn Nathan's death and celebrate his life.
It's hit the community really hard, and they just need an opportunity just to grieve together and to support each other and to pray together.
The seasons are changing in Lawrence. Instead of leaves, snow will fall, covering roads and walkways this winter. The images and thoughts of shoveling may be hard to think of now, but there's already plenty of concern about the city's fines for people not clearing their sidewalk. Karen Eager is good at clearing leaves, but when it comes to snow...
You know, I'm not very good, but I'm fortunate I have very good neighbors.
Neighbors who help keep her sidewalks clear and avoid the $72 fine if snow isn't shoveled within 48 hours. The combination of last winter's heavy snows and the ordinance's first year in effect resulted in more than 140 tickets.
I would be horrified if my failure to clean up caused somebody to slip and fall and get hurt.
Mainly kids. Instead of trick-or-treating, many will soon face the snow walking to school. Elliot Milko loves leaves, but his parents wouldn't want him knee-deep in snow on his way to school. While this family clears their sidewalks and beyond, they're concerned about the shoveling ordinance and how some may slip through the cracks.
I don't think it's fair for the whole community, especially the elderly.
So the city of Lawrence and Douglas County are making an extra and early push this year to get more volunteers signed up for the Safe Winter Walkways program. It provides help for the elderly and those in need with shoveling. Karen Eager applauds the volunteer effort, but says it should be more of a social responsibility to help out neighbors in need.
We've agreed to live in this town and benefit from all the good things that Lawrence has, that one of the things we ought to do is take some responsibility for our neck of the woods.
The shoveling citations in Lawrence stem from complaints. The number of complaints last year more than doubled the number of fines handed out. Dave Dunn, Fox 4 News, working for you.
Drop the gun! Come on, man! He shot down on
Lydia. You could hear the gunfire going over the police radio from Officer Payton, and he advised that he had been shot, which was the first time that I had ever been working when that's occurred. It was just an eerie feeling, helpless feeling.
Briggs was on his way to Officer Payton, but help had arrived there, and he knew he needed to find the suspect, David Logsdon. That's when the call came out.
Be advised, we have shots fired into the mall.
Briggs was close, and because he works there off-duty, he was familiar with the layout.
When I made entry into the store, it was a very eerie feeling because there was nobody around. I mean, it was as if the store was closed. And I just made my way searching for him or any victims.
Griggs wouldn't know until later that two people were killed in the parking lot, but it wouldn't have changed his plan.
I made my turn that leads from Target inside to the mall corridor, and that's when I located the suspect.
Griggs saw Logsdon before he saw Griggs. Armed with his patrol shotgun, he reacted in a split second. His training and instinct kicked in, and he knew what had to be done.
I fired one shot from my patrol shotgun and struck him on the right side of his body. And at that point in time, he still was standing holding the rifle in his arms, in his hands, and he turned the rifle towards me at that point. So we were now face to face. That's when I immediately fired the second round from the shotgun, striking him again, and he went down.
There was no hesitation for Griggs. This was an active shooter scenario. That's when there's a gunman whose goal is to kill or wound as many people as possible before the police arrive or the suspect kills himself. The longer the wait, the more lives lost.
You arrive at a scene, you get as many officers together immediately, you go in, you seek out the individual, and you take them out.
Griggs did his job, but he's quick to point out, Officer Payton did too.
I still give him the utmost respect for encountering this individual, before he went to Ward Parkway, because if he hadn't encountered him and taken the two handguns away from him and wounded him, which slowed him down prior to his arrival at the mall, this would have been much, much worse.
It would be several hours before Griggs and Payton would see and talk to one another. In that time, Griggs was debriefed. He was told Logsdon was dead. and that two people were killed outside before Griggs found him. He talked with detectives and commanders, but it wasn't until he got home and saw his wife and young daughter that it all set in. It was going to be tough for a while.
My wife was 100% supportive and still is, and knew that I had wanted to do this job for a long time, and this one incident wasn't going to change my feelings towards this job.
Griggs didn't just get support at home. He was well taken care of by his colleagues.
The support team, per se, and the law enforcement community is probably the best support team during an incident, critical incident like this, that you'll ever get at any job that you could find. It was constant phone calls and emails and making sure that I was doing okay.
In the weeks and months to follow, Officer Payton and Griggs received many honors for their efforts, from the Optimist Club to the Secret Service. Griggs was also awarded the Police Department's Medal of Valor, something he wears every day.
It's really hard to describe. I didn't expect to get a Medal of Valor in my career here. I'm honored to wear it, but given the circumstances, if the loss of life did not occur with this tragedy, I would feel a little bit better about it.
Recently, the two were in Washington, D.C. to receive yet another award. But this one was different. Their chief, Jim Corwin, nominated them for the Top Cops Award. It's a formal ceremony put on by the National Association of Police Organizations, and it honors the best of the best from across the nation. A year after Ward Parkway, the two still can't see what the fuss is all about. They still don't like the word hero, and they don't talk about April 29, 2007 without mentioning the other's name. And Griggs? Well, he's still humble and gracious.